Ladies and gentlemen, Tribeca Film Festival co-founder, Jane Rosenthal.
Good evening, everyone. It's my honor to complete our 2017 Tribeca Film Festival by introducing you to our moderator for this evening, Taylor Hackford, joined by, gentlemen, please come out, Robert De Niro, Talia Shire, Robert Duvall, Robert Duvall. Director Francis Ford Coppola. Pacino. Diane Keaton. And James Caan.
So, obviously, this is a huge honor for me to be able to moderate tonight's discussion with the original creators. This experience, this is what it's all about for us. You know, the idea of projecting a movie and having a live audience, and we were backstage, you could hear the audience responding. It was just fantastic. I'm going to throw it around and let everyone talk, obviously. It's really important to hear what people felt then and now. But one of the things I want to start with is that when you have a film like this that is so monumental in its impact, you know, its history, one tends to think, oh, well, it was always that way. It was this huge project in Hollywood. It was begun with all this auspicious talent, and Paramount knew what they had. When in reality, and I want to throw this to Francis in a moment, in reality, Paramount bought The Godfather. They'd had a horrible experience, a huge loser, called The Brotherhood, starring Kirk Douglas a few years before, and they didn't believe that mafia movies were going to work. So they literally had the idea that this would be a quickie, low-budget movie that they could put out to take advantage of the bestseller nature of The Godfather, but they didn't want to make a commitment. So when they first started to adapt it, they wanted to make it a contemporary film set in the 70s. And they did a script, and that didn't work. And then they finally started to say, well, what can we do to make this cheap and fast? In fact, the way it was described is cheap, dirty, and quick. And they were, this is the thing that's interesting. We're looking at this august group of people, but Francis Coppola was an independent filmmaker who had made The Rain People, which was a low-budget movie. Al Ruddy and Gray Fredrickson had made a film called Little Foss and Big Halsey, which their claim to fame was they came in under budget and and under $1 million, and that's why Paramount chose them. And I think that this is important to understand, that sometimes, all the time, Hollywood's looking at, they're usually wrong. In this instance, thank God they were. But I want to throw it to Francis, because he's got a fantastic piece about his notebook. In his notebook, he talked about one day in 1969 where three things happened in his life that changed it. Francis?
Take mine. Thank you.
Well, it's a true story. We were living in San Francisco, and it was a Sunday, and we had looked at the New York Times, and I looked at the book section, and noticed an ad that seemed intriguing. It had this puppeteer string, and was called The Godfather by Mario Puzo. I had never heard of it or of the author, and I was attracted to it because I thought it was a kind of foreign author, intellectual book about power. And just as I was, you know, thinking, I wonder what that is, there was a knock on the door, and it was Al Ruddy, whom maybe I had met him, and Gray Frederickson, and they were in San Francisco doing a little False and Big Halsey, which was a San Francisco location picture, and they heard that I had moved to San Francisco and were just dropping by. They weren't associated with The Godfather. And then the phone rang while they were there. And of all people, it was Marlon Brando calling me to turn down the script, The Conversation, which I had submitted to him. And I had never spoken or met Marlon Brando. And I was, you know, as any drama student from the 50s was, you know, Marlon Brando, Elia Kazan, and Tennessee Williams was the trio of most august people there could be. So on that one day, and he was very nice, Marlon turned me down, but called me personally to tell me that. And I've often thought how odd that is, that on that one day, Gray and Al Ruddy, who were going to be the producers of The Godfather, the book itself had really struck my eye, and Marlon Brando, who was eventually to appear in it, all kind of came together on one day. I tell that story, and I always say, but it's really true. It really happened on that one day. So it was pretty remarkable.
And Francis, tell us what you thought when you finally read the book.
I was disappointed in the book when I first read it because it was very long. I don't know if any of you have read the book, but a very, if you remember, much of the book, maybe a third or a quarter of it, was about Lucy Mancini's anatomy. You haven't read the book, I can see. And I thought the book was a little bit of a on the first reading, I thought it was a little bit of a pot boiler. May I say, just since I'm here with all these, many of the folks here I haven't seen recently, but I'd like to just thank those who aren't here anymore. Johnny Casale, Al Lettieri, who played Sollozzo, Salvatore Corsitti, who was the man in the beginning, I believe, in America, who got the part in an open call, and of course Marlon Brando. And I'm sure there are a couple of others, and certainly in part two. Pardon?
Michael Gazzo.
Oh, well, Michael Gazzo. Excuse me, not Michael Gazzo. He's in part two. I didn't get that. Richard Castellano. Yeah. And, of course, in part two, there were others. But also, let me very briefly thank some people who were very importantly involved in this movie, starting on the production end. Certainly Al Ruddy and Gray Frederickson. Bob Evans, a very controversial figure, a man, sort of an extraordinary man, not without talent, I must say. Made my life miserable, but he put a lot into The Godfather. And of course, the great Gordon Willis, who photographed it. And Dean Tavalaris, the production designer. Anna Hill Johnson, who did the costumes, and Nino Rota, who wrote the music, many other people, but I wanted to just mention those folks who were so importantly to do with this film.
I think that one of the things that we should start with, you know, this august group here all went on to other work. This is the beginnings of their careers. And if you think about it, it was an extraordinary coming together of talent, acting talent. And of course, you know, Fred Ruse, who's your partner for a long time and casting director.
Definitely, he should be mentioned with those others I just mentioned, who is Fred Ruse, who was the director of casting.
Yeah, but I think that this is an opportunity to have everybody here on stage. We'll begin by just talking about how this project came to them. Now, Bob, we'll wait for him because he's in two. But let's... he was waiting in the wings.
But he auditioned for the first one.
Well, that's the point we're going to make. Francis, I think in this instance, we're going to let each of these people talk about where they... And then if you want to chime in about... Because there's two factors here. There's the actor, and in this instance, it's the beginning of their career. So no one is really knocking at the door. Remember that most waiters and bartenders and waitresses that you go to see in New York, if you go into a place and you say, what do you do? They say, I'm an actor. They say, well, how do you pay your rent? Well, I'm paying my rent right now. You know, it's a tough time when you start in that business. And, you know, in this instance, when the phone call came or Francis came up and said whatever, it's a big moment. So let them talk, and then Francis, if you want to say what it was about them that drew you to it. So I want to start with Bob and Jimmy, because they had worked with you before. They were both in The Rain People, so they had an antecedent. Jimmy, let's start with you, because you go back before that. You guys went to Hofstra together, didn't you?
Well, he was a year ahead of me. You can tell by our speech pattern. But I knew Francis when I was 23, 24. He lived in the back of my house. What did I charge you? About 25 cents, 30 cents.
We didn't go to Hofstra at the same time. And he
no, not together.
And he wasn't involved in the drama department at Hofstra, which was why I was there.
No, I wasn't involved at Hofstra at all, actually.
You were there.
Yeah, no, I got out of there. But we did the Rain People, and the thing that you said that impressed me the most is that I said it this afternoon, but I don't think ever, and thanks to this guy right here, solely, has there ever been, for me, a gathering of actors like the likes of these people in this lovely lake. Nor has there been a crew that reached the top in every single one of their departments. So Francis, you know, somehow in his young little mind, just knew, you know, who had it and who didn't, and he knew where every character was at every second. And most importantly, I had a great time. Bobby, he was great, and Alan. Unfortunately, I didn't get to work with the other Bobby D down there, but I think I got together with him because of the Rain People, and it was just great. And the big thing is, I think because he was a Mediterranean Italian and not a Brooklyn Italian family.
Mr. Duvall. Let's talk a little bit about your experience on The Rain Men and coming to this.
The Rain People.
Well, I was in The Rain People, but I was only in The Rain People because somebody else got fired. remember that you put him out, and I came in. It was great to be there, you know, and with Jimmy and everybody in the Midwest, and after that George Lucas was there, and it was a wonderful experience, and I never got to know Francis that much because he was really very busy, and he didn't say much to me, but it was great being there. And then when we were going to do The Godfather, it was a kind of a makeshift kind of audition we all had up in San Francisco, right? But, you know, I want to thank Francis for giving me the part, and thank Bobby for having tonight. This is wonderful. You know, I don't know what else to say, except that we had a great time working together in The Godfather, and Brando particularly liked Jimmy Kahn because Jimmy can be pretty funny. And when Jimmy would tell a joke, it would take Brando like 3 seconds to get it. Then he'd go, then he would get it. But it was a great, good experience. And, you know, here we all are. And many years later. But I want to thank Francis for giving me the part. It was kind of a catalyst to my career, you know. Between him and Horton Foote, you know, there were two my people that really helped my career. So what else? Thank you.
Talia, let's talk about Connie. And let me just have one question. She's phenomenal. It's like, you know, just phenomenal. Your brother is doing this film. Did you know about the part and say, hey, I want that? Or did he come to you and say, hey, I got something for you?
Tell the truth.
I asked for an audition, and I was in that same place that you were in, that downstairs place. You were there. We were all sitting there. I asked for an audition. It was tough for me, and it was tougher for my brother. Honestly, we talked about this, didn't we, Bob, this morning, that, you know, during that first Godfather, for a few weeks, your job as the director was up for grabs. And the last thing he needed was a sister who couldn't figure out what a mark was. You know, and I think one of my first scenes, I walked into the camera and knocked it down. I did that. It was Marlon Brando. That's okay. But I mean, I have to tell you, it wasn't easy. And you didn't need me to be there, but you were very kind, and thank you.
At first, I didn't see Tally as Connie because I felt, from my interpretation, that Connie was a kind of homely Italian daughter that only got to marry a good-looking guy like the husband she did because she was, you know, she was a wealthy and powerful girl. To me, I thought Tally was so beautiful that anyone would want to marry her, much less that she's the daughter. So I thought she was wrong for the part. I thought she should be a girl who was sort of homely. And you can see the logic of that. And I must say that it was Bob Evans who championed her. And at a time, you know, the cast was always up in the air, and there was a lot of controversy, which Al will tell you about. And at one point, you know, I went to England to, and even regarding Marlon Brando, but I did go to, I was sent to England to meet Marlon Brando, and I did. He was making a picture there, and he was very gracious. But when I got back, I just called in a phone booth my secretary, and she said, I'm so important. I had a message to call her, and she said, very important, don't quit, let them fire you. And I knew immediately what that meant. It meant that if they, you know, I didn't have any money, I had two kids and one on the way, and I was totally broke. And I knew that if they fired me, then they'd have to pay me, but if I quit, they wouldn't. So I thought it was all over. And so I called the studio, and they, thinking, you know, why should I even come in if you're going to fire me? And they said, okay, it was a big shuffle, and if we have time and go into the different changes in the casting, but they said, okay, it's going to be Al Pacino is going to play Michael, Jimmy Kahn is going to play Sonny, and you were never a doubt, Bobby. You were always 100% agreed upon after the Raimis in my mind, but also I didn't get any static about you. And Tally will play Connie. And You know, I had sort of felt as long as I'm going to get fired, probably my sister should at least get the chance.
But that, do you see what a
those are very those are very. I mean,
conflict
it's,
for you to have me when all of that was.
No, once we did it and rehearsed it, then I could see that you were working really well. But that's, you know.
That's good. I'm gonna Al. I'm saving you for last. Let's go to Diane.
Let's not.
Diane.
If it works. Oh, here I am. Sorry.
How did this project come to you?
How did, you know, I honestly, really, I don't know. And the strangest thing about it was that, you know, I auditioned and it seemed to me, now, maybe I got this wrong, Francis, but it seemed to me I got the part before, but I didn't understand why. I still don't. But then I read recently that Francis thought I was eccentric. Yeah, right. So he wasn't wrong, but then really, it was really interesting because it seemed to me like I auditioned with several other potential Michaels. Am I right?
I saw you. You auditioned with 100 Michaels.
Didn't I? Yeah.
Yeah. But I had seen you and Richard Castellano in Lovers and Other Strangers.
Oh, my God. And that's why I make, yeah.
And from that picture, I thought you would be an excellent.
You did?
Okay, yeah. And, you know, to say you were eccentric, that's not
so
entirely. But what it was is Kay was written as this New England WASP in the book and thing. And she was pretty straight. Mm-hmm. And I felt, how could she have the interest and something beyond being a beautiful, kind of that type
a woman.
Of WASP. WASP woman, how could she have some stuff that would be interesting? And I felt that you would, just the mere casting of you playing the beautiful WASP girlfriend would give it a lot of texture and interest. And that's why I cast.
Well, I appreciate that.
So now we come to the role of Michael. And this is a saga in itself. Bob Evans was mentioned. My research says that Bob Evans did not want Al Pacino, thought he was too, quote, short for the role. I mean, seriously, in much more derogatory terms.
That's sort of
terms.
True, right?
No, guess. It's not true at all. But the fact is that you know, this is what happens at a studio. As a filmmaker, you know, you go in and you've got your idea, and obviously Francis... And I'll have you ask in a second, Francis, what you saw in Al, because Al had done Panic in Needle Park.
But that hadn't come out.
It hadn't come out. Did you see it?
No.
Oh, my God.
No. But Panic in Needle Park, he was doing it, and it came out much later.
Really?
Ultimately, they did see it. Evans and Paramount people did see it close to, pieces. Close to the time when... You know, they made that final switch.
Well, then
but what was interesting was that Al had gotten a part in The Gang That Couldn't Shoot Straight, so he wasn't even available when they finally made the decision.
I know that, but tell us what you saw in Al. If you didn't see in Panic in Needle Park, it's a fantastic part. What did you see when he came
in
to audition?
In a nutshell, what it was is that I had met Al. Al came to San Francisco to visit me. I had written another screenplay about a kind of guy like me, you know, Italian guy, and I wanted. I heard Al was a wonderful theater actor, and I invited him to come to San Francisco. And he came, and he spent maybe almost a week or 5 days with me, and I got to hang out with him and enjoy his company. So that later, when they gave me the Godfather script to read. Every time I read it, I always saw his face. And in the scene in particular, when he was walking across Sicily with the shepherds, I just saw, you know, the handsome young guy with black hair. And I, once you see someone in the role from during the reading of it, it's very hard to get that out of your head.
Yeah. Now, Al, let's talk about as a young actor. Mm. You have a director who wants you to have the part, and you have a studio that's sending very negative messages. How many times did you test for this role?
Oh, countless. I can't count it. It seemed like I was always testing, didn't it? I kept testing after I got the part.
Well, I remember once I called him after he had tested six times, and his girlfriend got on the phone, and I said, Val, would just come in one more time. And she says, what are you doing to him? And she just yelled at me and berated me. You're torturing him.
And that's true. Although you weren't
torturing him. The moment is very clear.
Yeah, I mean, you weren't torturing him, but
Well, actually, you know, I even said to him, I mean, without Francis, you know, where would I be, really? But at the same time, I even said to him, please, Francis, it's okay. We'll work again. There's other things to do, you know. I mean, he said, no, I want you. I thought, this can't be happening, you know. I mean, I'm dreaming or something. This is too much. I said, oh, okay, fine then. I'll do whatever, you know. And then we finally got accepted in some way, and that's to France.
I think it was a Panic Needle Park when they finally saw some footage and saw his power, you know, on the frame. But I think these
things go on, and then at a certain point, you know, as an actor.
You don't want to do it anymore. I mean, really, it's just a thing with me. I'll say it because it's true. You don't want to be somewhere where you're not wanted. I even said it to him. I'm not interested in that at all.
And then you got another part.
What?
You got the gang who couldn't shoot straight.
In the middle of this whole process.
Bobby was involved in that.
I know. I'm
Bobby had done a wonderful reading in the audition. One that you said, wow.
Michael?
Actually, it was for Sonny.
For Sonny.
But it was like totally unusual and real and just different. And I was very impressed. And so I for sure wanted him to be in the movie, even if it couldn't be. So I cast him as Paulie Gatto, guy who was the traitor. And then he called me and said, well, he's up for a part in the gang shouldn't shoot, but he didn't know if he wanted to take because he didn't want to lose the Paulie Gatto. I said, well, go up for it. If you get it, great. If you don't, I'll hold the part for you. I won't cast anyone else. And if you don't get it, you'll always have that. We'll be there. So he did get the part. So that when I came back from England and I heard that, he didn't get the part in and so he was going to play Paulie Gatto. And then Al got a part in Gang Couldn't Shoot Straight. And it was legally signed and everything, so I didn't know how they could put him in the Godfather.
Yeah. I think this is an interesting
story. And they wound up suing me.
Well, it's an interesting story.
So by the time I finished Godfather 1, I had no money, but I owed $15,000 for lawyers. So yeah. I remember that.
But the interesting thing that's aside, and this is a film about the mafia, but Al is signed to MGM to do The Gang Who Couldn't Shoot Straight. And Paramount finally decides to put him in The Godfather. Yeah. And the guy who was running MGM was a guy called Jim Aubrey, who was also known as the Smiling Cobra. He had been head of CBS. He was now head of MGM, taking it down. Not an easy man. And Bob Evans, you know, didn't know his way around Hollywood. He called a man named Sidney Korshak, who was the mob's fixer in Hollywood. He's not known. He never had an office.
Sort of like the scene with Bobby played with the Hollywood producer in The Godfather. He was a lawyer who was...
He was a lawyer from Chicago who represented the Chicago mob in Hollywood. And Bob Evans talked to him. He called Jim Aubrey, and Al told me the story. All of a sudden, Al was able to do it. Bobby got the gang who couldn't shoot straight. And in this instance, you see they're both getting their first big roles. Amazing story.
Yeah.
And you finally got what you wanted, Francis, even though they threatened to fire you for keeping to... You still wanted to do him.
But the test that Bobby talks to, that they all went to San Francisco, interestingly, including Diane, everyone, they had the whole cast for like a $6 screen test. That my wife was doing the haircuts and they had the whole cast, but then they were not satisfied, so we then spent hundreds of thousands of dollars doing screen tests with every bright young leading man and many, you know, just I would think In fact, we did so many screen tests that I remember, and this is no doubt true, that Charlie Bluthorn said, he had a Viennese accent. He was an interesting guy. He had a Viennese accent. He said, I saw 200 screen tests. They're all terrible. He says, those actors can't all be terrible. There are so many actors, but there's only one director. It's the director who's terrible.
Charles Bluthorn had a big conglomerate called Gulf and Western, and he owned Paramount, and he was a colorful character. Now, Francis, now that we've talked about the people on the stage, I think it's really interesting that you wrote a part, The Conversation, which is a fantastic movie, for Marlon Brando, and he turned it down. How did you convince Marlon Brando to do this role?
Well, it wasn't a matter of convincing Marlon Brando. It was a matter of convincing Paramount, because I never talked to Marlon again after that turndown, but I was told by the executives of Paramount that absolutely Brando, who had been in Quemada, the film Burn, which was not successful, that having Brando in the film would be less commercially than if a total unknown did it. And finally, I was told by the president of it that, Francis, as president of Paramount Pictures, I'm telling you, Marlon Brando will not appear in this picture, and I prohibit you from bringing up his name again. Mm. And after that, I sort of, like Kevin Kline, I fell on the floor in a faint, and they all looked. And I said, well, if I can't even talk about him, I said, how could I? What am I supposed to do? I think Marlon Brando would be great. And Fred Roos, who was involved in all of the people, especially everyone, Bobby and Johnny Casale, he brought in, and many people. So they said to me, all right, if Marlon will do it for nothing, if he'll do a screen test, if he'll do it for nothing, and if he'll put up $1 million bond that he won't cause trouble during the production, then you can have him. And I said, I accept. And ultimately, they left the door open just a teeny bit, and then a whole lot of stuff went on of how he actually got the part.
Brando was 47 when he did this role, and you see him on the screen, you can't believe it. Dick Smith was the makeup person you used. Was it Dick Smith, or did Brando just
Brando
become?
Himself, I mean, Dick Smith was a genius at what he did, and he took it to the next level. But when I went to Brando's home that early morning to do this, I had said to Brando, oh, we'd do some improvisation. I didn't say it was a screen test. And I went and I brought, a lot of provolone cheese and salami, the props I could put around. He came out of his bedroom early in the morning. He was a beautiful man. He had long blonde hair, and he had a Japanese robe on. And there were not a lot of words spoken. He saw me there. He saw there was a camera. And he took his hair and he rolled it up, put shoe polish on it, and put a shirt on, and then started bending the colors. They always have their colors bent, and he would take a little of the provolone and started, and then he took some paper and stuffed it in his jaws, and he said, these should be like a bulldog, I remember. And then he also said he was shot in the throat, so maybe he should talk like, and he started. And he started turning into the character. And even as he was there doing that, the phone rang, and he was going, and he picked up the phone and said, I don't know who was on the phone, but he had totally turned into the character, and I had it all on videotape, and that's really what sold, did the trick.
I mean, when you have this in mind that Brando, because we know who Brando is and what he had done. I mean, Quemada, he was just incredible in, but everything. But when you see something like that happen in front of your eyes, were you inside jumping up and clicking your heels?
Oh, I thought it was miraculous, I was very impressed with him. I communicated with him. You don't talk to Marlon in, like, about acting stuff. He just wants to hear louder or not so loud, or he wants to be told where the camera frame is going to be, and then he proceeds. Or you can put props to him, like I put that cat in his hand, and he just would use whatever.
Did you literally pick that cat up and put it in his hands?
That was a studio cat. Yeah, one take, only one take.
Oh my God.
Put it in his.
Oh my God.
You know. That was a question that I was going to ask, because when you see, you know, you see the Undertaker first talking, and then you finally come around and see Brando, and when you see him, he's sitting there, you know, it doesn't look like Marlon Brando that we knew at the time, and there is this amazing cat in his lap, and it just, the cat is so comfortable, and he's scratching the cat, and you hear the cat purring. In fact, one of the things I'd read from the sound department, they said they went to Dailies, and they said, what the hell is he saying? In Paramount, they're watching Dailies. Said, we can't hear anything except the cat.
Well, Brando had a wonderful way with children and animals. And, you know, he loved children and animals, and he was just very comfortable, and they were comfortable with him.
Yeah. I think one last thing I want to do, and then we're going to go on to other things, but one, you know, there is somebody, and you mentioned him already, who's not here, and that's John Cassola. I mean, I know he was very, you know, there's an amazing thing that happened a couple of years ago at the end of Barack Obama's term as president. He went to Tahoe to give a speech, and the local paper, I happened to read this, local paper wrote, you know, interviewed him and said, what do you think of beautiful Lake Tahoe? He says, the only thing I could do when I was flying in, I saw it, was poor Fredo. I mean, that in itself is such an amazing tribute to this film, these films, because there's that's what he thought of. He's looking at this beautiful thing and he's thinking about John Cassola. What did you think when you met him? Did Al introduce you to him?
Fred Roos brought him. Brought him, and it was a natural. He should definitely be Fredo, but he was a friend.
He was a very close friend of mine, yeah. And we had worked a lot together. We had done plays.
You know, Dog Day Afternoon. He was.
Well, no, Dog Day Afternoon came after.
Dog Day Afternoon came after. But when you see, you just happen to see the scene. You know, when this is in Godfather 2, we have to jump back and forth. But my God, that scene where he's in the chair and he says, "I'm smart." I'm not, I mean, it's just, you watch somebody coming apart on the screen. Looking at that performance still just is so stunning. And again, I think nobody acts alone, so you're all feeding off each other. Jimmy, you were going to say something.
That was about the cat.
Oh, it was, okay. Well, let me ask you, Jimmy, while we're here, because Bobby Duvall said, tell him about the story when Brando needed to get emotional in a scene.
Oh, God. Well, it was when I was laying there dead with 147 bullet wounds in me or whatever. And Brando had to get emotionally prepared. And
bring it up.
Francis said, let's
Use
go.
Your mic.
Give
Use
me
your
a
mic.
Moment,
please,
mic.
Give me a moment. You know, so.
Use the mic.
Oh, about a day later. I don't do this. A day later, Bobby had to do something, and I said, would you give Bobby a moment, please? And Bobby said, and he just walked across the stage. That's all he did.
Use your mic.
Huh?
Use your mic.
Oh, hey, Bobby just walked across the stage. But the thing that I did want to say about Brando and his availability to everything and his that cat, I remember being there that morning, and that was the morning. Wasn't it just that same morning you put the cat there?
The cat's only in one take.
Yeah.
It was just a studio
cat. That
cat
sat there like it was there for a thousand years. And he just never even referred to it. You give any actor a pop.
I mean, the amazing thing about the cat, too, he's sitting in the lap, and when Brando gets up, he puts the cat on the desk, and the cat just sits down on the desk. It's like you feel that is Vito's cat, and that he really is comfortable with that. I mean, you know, when that happens, it's serendipity.
Yeah.
I just as an interesting note, but I think the key for me of what happened that made that family was the remember the rehearsal when we just had met Brando for the first time and we had a dinner in the back of Patsy's restaurant. Yeah. And it was like, and Tally served the food, and you were sitting to the right, and Bobby was sitting next to, and they, everyone was excited because Brando was there, and you know, Jimmy was like telling lots of jokes and trying to impress him that way, and Al was just looking serious, trying to impress him, and every time Brando looked away, Bobby would do an impression of Brando. And John Casal was and after the, and Tally was serving the food, the plates, and after that dinner, it made me realize that improvisation with food is very lasting, and they sort of had who they were going to be after that.
Yeah, that's true. Remember that? That's true.
It was easy because he was like the godfather to young actors, really.
Yeah.
Brando.
Oh yeah. I want to tell one quick funny story about Francis. We had Luca Brasi there one day, and he had to come in to the door. I said it this morning, but this shows you his genius. Oh, the phone, yeah. All right. Anyway, Luca Brasi, he came in. He said, "Don Colio, I am honored to be here on the day of your daughter's wedding." And Francis kept looking at him and looking at him. He goes, "Jimmy, do something." I said, "What?" He said, "Go do something." "What should I do?" "Just make him funny. Make him do something different." So I went over and I said, and I knew Lenny, so because he was the biggest, strongest guy of all time. And I said, "Lenny, you got to do me a favor. When the door opens," and he was in a close-up, "when you say, 'Don Corleone,' stick your tongue out." And I put a piece of tongue, a tape on his tongue, that said F you on it, right? And so for good, so he opened the door and he went, "Don Corleone," right? So everybody laughed. Francis, "Oh, this is great." So then he opened the door again, he's Don Corleone, and Marlon had F you too on it. but the brilliance of it was, when we went back to do it, he never changed. Never changed one syllable, never changed the tone. So Francis, 3 weeks later, I think it was, at the wedding, he came up with Luca Brasi in the court, which was never there, studying the speech and made it work like that. It was brilliant.
Yeah, we shot that after.
Yeah. In other words, you did the scene in the office first and then shot outside.
Well, he never did get through the lines. You said the daughter, your daughter's, when he kept sort of fumbling, so I thought if we shot him practicing it, it would then be funny.
Now Francis, let's talk about Lenny, and I mean, Luca Brasi is such a unique character.
All I know
is he a real actor? Was he an actor?
Well, let me put it this way. There's a scene where he takes out a gun and he puts bullets and spins it. I said, "Okay, take out the gun and flip it open and put bullets and spin it." He said, "Can you do that?" And he looked at me and said, "Are you kidding?"
So that's what I'd heard. I'd heard that Lenny was actually the real deal. But still. There it is. Now, the important thing before we go on, this is, and listen, I figure that any of you want to leave, you can leave. But the fact is, this is a historic night. I want to stay here and get as much as we can get.
Taylor, I feel that Al didn't get to talk about getting the part. I told my side of it, and he didn't tell his.
Well, that is such a long story, and but it starts with Francis and I in San Francisco getting to know each other because he wanted me to play another role, and then it was really great spending. I went to Zoetrope, and sitting around a pool table was Spielberg and George Lucas. They're all kids, you know, and they had never done a movie, I don't think.
And I remember everywhere the girls always liked him. I said, "How come the girls like him so much?" But everywhere we went in San Francisco, like, the girls lit up for some reason. Even when after Diane did a million screen tests, she came to me and she said, pick Al, pick Al.
Anyway, I got back, and then I have, you know, they didn't want us, they didn't want me, actually, for the movie. He had written a beautiful movie. You know, Francis wrote Patton, you know, George C. Scott. He wrote that screenplay. And he's a great director and a great writer, and it was a great script. That script was wonderful. Almost abstract, surreal movie about a professor who falls in love with one of his students. It was beautifully written. Anyway, they turned us down, they turned me down, and then Francis never did it. And I went away, and I said bye. And a year later, my phone rings in my apartment, and I pick it up, and he says, hey, Al, hi. I said, who's this? He says, it's Francis. I said, Francis? Yes. Oh, Francis, yes, he made an impression, but it was a year, you know, and my life was in sort of strange place, but I said, thank you. Francis, it's so good to hear you. Hi, how are you? He said, I'm pretty good. Listen, I just want you to know I'm doing The Godfather. And I said, what's the matter with him? There's something wrong with him. Because The Godfather was the biggest book, the biggest film, and then I thought he's now, it's, you know, it's tough in Hollywood, you know, you get, anyway, I thought that it was very strange. And I said, well, that's good, Francis. So I was humoring him. I said, fine, I think that's great. Wow, he says, yes, he said, it is. And I had read the book. I said, it's a great book. You know, it's really very entertaining. And he says, yeah, he says, and I tell you, I'm thinking of using you as Michael Corleone. And I thought, now he's really nuts here. You know, it's, so I thought, okay, let me just think about this for a second. I flash on the book, and right away I'm thinking, as an actor does, you know, I thought, gee, it's not a good role. It's Sonny is the part I can play. You know, it's got meat in it that you could really get out there and, you know, do what Jimmy does and try to do it anyway. And there I was on the phone with him thinking, I don't think I can do Michael, you know. And he said, Michael is you. I didn't say that. I just said, wow, that's really, you know, I almost said strange, but I didn't. Anyway, that was it. And I hung up the phone and thought, well, this is either a dream or a joke or whatever it is, but sure enough, it was real. And then started that whole, you know, trial and of them not wanting me and Francis wanting me.
What it really was is that, you know, Bob Evans was quite a tall, good-looking guy, and originally he wanted Brian O'Neill or Redford, and don't laugh because there are blonde Sicilians. Sicilians are famously blonde because they were under the French were there for 200 years, so there are blonde, blue-eyed Sicilians. But I finally realized that, you know, Bob wanted someone who looked like him to play Michael, and I wanted someone who looked like me. Not that you, but you're
oh, I see.
Oh, when I was thinner, you know, and I had dark hair.
Yeah, you did. You had. We could be related in a way. But I was very. I just want to say this: when a director wants you for a part, you're lucky. You know, I mean, it's really something. It's like somebody who likes you. You don't know why they like you, but they just like you. So you sort of like them, right? I mean, that's sort of the thing. Yeah, he likes me so much. I don't know. I like him. Yeah. So he wanted me so much. I thought, well, maybe I can play this role or something. And I labored over that. But the studio didn't want me, as we've been through before. And yet, and then they didn't want me after they hired me. Did I say that at all? Yeah. And while we were filming, Francis was, you know, concerned. Again, I was new to films. I didn't know what to do quite. But I had a sense of this character because I would think about it all the time. It was in me all. I was living on 90th and Broadway, and I walked to the Village and back every day. Well, it's not a big thing, but I did it. And I did it thinking about this role. just trying to figure out how, where could I go with it, you know. And finally, I didn't quite know. I had some idea. Of course, I was unable to articulate it to Francis at the time. I just didn't have the, you know, as you can tell, I mean, it's not easy for me to talk. But you'll get used to it. But in any event, I came and I started filming, and it was dizzying, you know, the whole thing, Diane and I in that wedding thing. I mean, we got so loaded after that wedding scene. I can't tell you.
You can't
we were
tell,
on the floor.
You can't tell from that wedding scene where he tells her about the guy and your brains and the contract. That was literally shot at night because we were so late. We had lost the light, and we were in deep trouble schedule-wise, and they just pumped light yeah. into, I don't know if you remember.
A lot of chaos going on there,
It was
yeah.
very, very dark.
But we were theater actors. We were not used to film, and I think that was very, the whole thing had a kind of surreal feeling to it. We got back, and we started drinking. We were just talking about, where do we go from here? You know, we're gone. It's over. This is the worst film ever made. We know nothing about it, you know. So there it is, and we're going along, and I'm going. I come back in. I don't ask. Nobody talks to me, and pretty only Francis who would talk to me. But the great guy for me on this picture was Al Ruddy. For some reason, Al would always come up to me during the shooting and come up to me and say, "Hey, kid, come here, Pacino. Listen to me. You're gonna be great. You're gonna be great in this picture. You're great. You understand?" I say, "Oh, yeah, thanks." You know, I didn't know what I was doing, but it was really encouraging. He was the only one who spoke to me. Because I would do scenes, you know, and I'd be in the middle of a scene somewhere, and I'd hear some stuff. I really heard, it wasn't just hearing things, I heard people were giggling, you know. They were sort of snickering. I thought, what is that about? And it was about me, you know. Where did Francis get this guy? I remember Francis, actually, you remember the time you called me into the Ginger Man? Do you remember that at all? What did you say? You were really cool. You were sitting there with your family, and you were very nice to me. The only thing you didn't do was you didn't ask me to sit down at the table, which I took as a sort of strange, you know, reaction. And I thought, well, I'll stand here then. And you told me straight out that I got to start getting my chops together. You know, it's not, you know, I got great confidence in you, but I sort of, in a way, you were saying, you know, I sort of don't know what you're doing. And then you did one of the most wonderful things. You said, "I've prepared the rushes, the takes that you've done, and they're at Paramount." Remember that now? Is that coming to you? No? Oh. Well, maybe you'll dream about it again tonight or something. But there I was, looking at...
To show you the stuff.
Yeah, you showed me the stuff. I mean, that was amazing. He said, "Take a look at what you're doing." And I looked at it in this room by myself, and it's just big, and sitting there thinking, "Well, that isn't very good," or whatever it is. It seems okay. It doesn't even seem okay, but it doesn't matter, because my mind was always thinking that Michael was something I was going for the ending of the movie, which makes him somewhat enigmatic, you know, and early on he's like someone who you don't pay attention to much, so that when the transition comes, right, finally when he becomes the Don, you go, "Whoa, where did that come from?" That was my hope, and I tried to orchestrate my role that way. And so, but I sort of knew that I was doing it, but I was really on the wrong track. So I went to him and said, "I see what you mean. I see what you mean," because I didn't know what else to say to him, because he was convinced of it. So I said, "I see what you mean." And then he did what is the most brilliant thing anybody could do. He actually changed the schedule. He took the Sollozzo scene where Michael shoots this Sollozzo and the captain, and he put it up front. It wasn't scheduled for that day. And so because the studio was done with me, I was gone. And he showed him the Sollozzo scene, and they kept me.
Oh, this is done.
Yeah. Wow.
Did I miss something there?
Oh, it's true that that scene, the shooting of the Solozzo scene, was like the very early in the schedule, quite early. Maybe this, I know the first day was you and Diane at Best in Company, but it was maybe the second week we shot that scene. And that scene was, even Paramount realized how strong Al was.
That I could play Michael.
For sure.
You know, you don't understand what it's like from a studio point of view. These people have dailies, and they project dailies, and the head of the studio is there literally taking phone calls from agents. Here you are, you know, your work is up on the screen. They're supposed to be watching and evaluating, but they get, I need to get him. I missed their call. So they're sitting there while the work is on the screen. This is the process of the studio system. It still goes on today. But, you know,
I always didn't understand that quite, because we all know, being, you know, film actors, and everything is the cut. It's how a scene is cut together. I mean, that's how, I won't look at rushes anymore, because it's you know, you see this close-up that goes on forever, you know, and then you have, but it's how the editor cuts the film with the director that counts.
The process.
So I won't look at them anymore,
that's,
you know?
I know, but that's the process, Al. That's from a filmmaking point of view. What I'm trying to say is these people aren't filmmakers.
No, I know.
They sit there but Francis is out in the field saying, and he had to fight for Al to begin with, and then they're telling him, Francis, if you keep this up, you're fired.
Well, what I was told on the third week when we shot Brando, his first scene, Brando's first scene was in the olive oil company with Solozzo, and they hated Brando in it. They thought he mumbled, and they hated the film looking, the photographer liked very dark footage, to say the least. So it was very dark. And so we're out down there in Little Italy, across the street from where we were shooting that scene. And Gray Fredrickson came to me on a Tuesday and said, you know, they're going to fire you this weekend. And I realized, of course, they fire the director on the weekend, so the new director has time so they don't lose any, to turn around, prepare, and then Monday there's a new director. And I realized there was a group of around, I don't know, 12 people who were the naysayers, who were the ones who were actively trying to get me fired. So on that Tuesday, I fired those 12 people. Because I had said, if you don't like Brando, let me go up there and, you know, it was his first day, after all, I'll shoot it again. And they said no, and I was very puzzled. I wonder why they wouldn't. It was so easy to just jump up. I could have done it in a half a day. And then that's when he told me they're going to fire you. And then I fired the 14 people, and I went up, and we shot that scene again. And I'm sure there were lots of phone calls of, can he do this? And, you know, even I didn't know if I had the authority to do it. I just figured I'm the director, if I want to fire them, that at least we'll throw them into confusion. And then they decided that weekend that, after all, probably it'll be a big bad publicity to fire me that weekend. So Bluthorn took me and my father out to the Palm Steakhouse and told me, you know, that they saw the footage, the new footage of Brando, and it was much better, and sort of gave me a real confidence that they're not going to, that I'm with it. Ironically, in the movie, that's the first shooting. The scene in the picture is not the second time we shot it. It's the first time, that the one that they didn't really like.
See, the thing is, I think it's important for you to understand that, you know, because we're here, because this is monumental, because these films have gone on, but this is the process, what, you know, a young filmmaker making a film, and he's got to get the confidence of all these people on stage and make it all happen with his crew. In the meantime, he's thinking, I'm out of here this weekend. It's
It's understandable. I mean, you know, when you're doing something and you get lucky, as obviously did with what's such a collection of talent, and you know, if it's different, if it rubs people at first the wrong way, or if it's not like something before that was successful, you know, everyone's scared. So of course, it's logical to think, maybe you ought to get another director, you know, because the Godfather is very dark. Yes. You know, I mean, darker than most movies were. And Brando did mumble a little bit. You know, that's his style. And he does it deliberately. He told me that he doesn't, that when he does his lines, he tries not to move his mouth very much, so it's easy to loop any lines you want in there.
Yeah. Now, well, he believed in dubbing. I mean, really, hit. That was one of his major things. After the film is over, post-production, he taught me that. And I found that is very helpful in film. If you can, you know, lip sync. And I didn't know about the mouth not moving much. Well, that's it. Yeah. Well, I'll try that next time.
You know, one of the things that we should also talk about before we finish the casting. What? You know what?
Baptism.
Don't worry, we're going to be here. But let's talk about this important thing. And that is, and this is a revolutionary. This is the reason this film could be made by only an Italian. It's an Italian movie. And Francis had the revolutionary concept of making a film and casting Italian actors. You know, if you look at the Brotherhood, you look at these other movies. They're casting everybody. Well, Jimmy's not Italian, all right.
But he's sort of honorary.
One Italian of the year twice.
Yeah, right. he's honorary Italian.
But the fact is that a lot of the actors in this movie are Italian. And in Hollywood, they didn't do that. And I think that this film reeks of authenticity and cultural identity that actually fits the subject. And you actually took this piece and made it about America and about immigrants in America.
But, you know, the thing was, he was not a Brooklyn Italian. He was a Mediterranean Italian, and everything had to do with you.
I'm a Long Island Italian.
No, but, I mean, everything was about music and art, and it was okay. You know, I'd killed somebody because of my sister, or 80 guys died. The only question I used to get asked was that a real horse. Nobody came to my 81 people got killed. Was the horse real? Yeah, the horse was real. But that, you know what I mean. Everything was okay for the sake of family. Let's
take 1 second and we'll get to the baptism. But Gordon Willis, you selected this film has some of the darkest photography ever in it. You had not worked with him before. What was it, Clute? What drew you to want to work with him?
Well, when the first movie I made was edited by a gentleman named Aram Avakian. And Aram Avakian had directed a film based on, what was it called? Yeah. And the photographer was Gordon Willis. And I had heard about him and admired him through that connection with Aram Avakian.
Well, it's just it was a revolutionary look. Extraordinary.
Yeah. Well, he was, you know, Gordy Willis is one of the greats, all-time greats in the cinematography.
Since we had a lot of people out there saying the baptism, clearly the baptism.
What about the baptism would you like to know?
Well, it's, you know, first of all, let's talk about the music, the intercutting, all of that.
What had happened with the baptism was in the, you know, a screenwriter is constantly trying to figure out how to get into one sitting or a two-hour, 10-minute movie from a novel, which, of course, you read over evening. And you're constantly looking for ways to condense and smush stuff in a novel into the script. So my idea was to take what was, you know, 40 pages of the novel, and through the device of the baptism ceremony, kind of wrap it all up for the end of the picture that way. So at first it was a screenwriting device on how to get a lot of pages in the novel expressed in a short time, and let the event of the baptism, let all the murders and wiping out the five families rotate around that. It was the editor, and the first cut, it wasn't really working, and we had two editors, wonderful editors. One of them, who was working on the second half of the film, named Peter Zinner, had the idea to put in that organ, and that organ just totally, once he put that in, it just gelled, and the baptism really was worked.
We've had the man to my right has been very quiet tonight. He's our host. Because we've all been talking about Godfather 1, but I think, Bob, I want to, you know, it's an amazing pressure to come in at a certain point. You're coming into Godfather 2, and Marlon Brando has won the Academy Award for the role that you're playing. How was that process? And here, I'm going to give you this. Okay. How was that process, and what was your feeling about, you know, confecting this role?
No, I was honored that Francis asked me to do the part, and I said, you know, this is great. And so I remember that Gray Frederickson and I went up to the Gulf and Western Building, Paramount, when it was at Columbus Circle, and it was like 30-something floor or whatever, in a screening room, took a tape recorder, the old, you know, reel-to-reel, and filmed the scenes that Brando was in. And I played them over and over again for myself as I was working on it. But it wasn't, it was great. I looked at it in a kind of a scientific way. I had to sort of find spots where I could do stuff to imitate what he's doing. And I enjoyed it, you know.
May I just offer that in my idea to, you know, obviously to get someone to play Brando role as a young man is daunting. But I didn't think of it as Brando. I said, you know, whether Bobby looks like Brando or could play, you know, the guy in some other Brando page, but I thought he could play Vito Corleone's character the way Brando created him, that he could be the younger Vito Corleone without ever going through Brando. You know what I'm saying? That you just don't think of Bobby's not like a Brando lookalike necessarily. But he could capture what Vito Corleone might have been as a young man, which he did.
Well, he absolutely did. I think to the point that he did, because I think this is the only time in history that two actors have won the Academy Award playing the same role in two different films. So I think you were right. Well, I'm getting the hook here. I'd like to go on all night, but we sure,
could the audience ask four or five questions so they can.
Is there if you've got a nice strong voice, shout some things up. All right, that's going to be very tough.
All right, first, is it possible to put the house lights up a little bit so we can see them? Okay. So now you can point to someone waving their hand and we'll get the right, gentleman right there.
Here's the lady standing down here.
Yeah, who's that? Go ahead. I haven't seen these movies for years. I tend not to see the movies I worked on, and I sat there. I know I haven't seen Godfather 2 for a really long time. I saw the first Godfather because we had to do the restoration because the print was not in good shape. But I found it a very emotional experience. I forgot a lot about the making of it, and I was more in the story. And the story used a lot of family, my personal stuff, where it had, you know, my sister in it and things in the script I had deliberately. So I found it a very emotional experience for myself.
Diane told me today that you'd seen the film recently.
I saw it on my computer. I did, and I hadn't seen it for, I think, about 30 years or something like that. And I looked at one, and I just remember, all I can think of is, I couldn't get over it. It was so astonishing. It was, Francis, it was so beautiful. And everybody is so great in it. And the music is so, every choice you made was so authentically brilliant. I mean that. And that, it's so unusual.
You know.
I mean, it's just like, I
just kept crying. And that damn Talia, you know, I saw her in that scene where they were just fighting and screaming. Oh my God! No, I'm not kidding. The whole movie was, and then you had slow, long scenes where it was just the guys and the guys together, and then suddenly there was this vicious thing that happened. You know, you're just going like, I'd just be blown out of the ballpark crying over Talia. I mean, everything was like astonishing to me, and I was totally surprised because I didn't expect it. Okay, and on a fucking computer. I mean, that's where I am. I'm on the computer.
Diane?
So I really can't get over it. I'm so emotional about it. I was so shocked because I never really paid much attention to The Godfather because I always felt like I was the most outsider, weird person, you know, in the movie. And why was I cast again? And I had no voice. You know, I was just kind of like this. But then there was a couple good scenes with Al.
You know the scene where you tell Al that the very important scene where you tell Al that it wasn't a miscarriage, it was an abortion.
Oh no, I'll never forget that.
That was Tally's idea.
Talia, all right, girl.
It was Tally's idea that she has the abortion as her way to.
You had that idea.
That was her idea.
You wrote that.
Right here. Shout it out. Wait.
Last question, please.
Well, obviously, there's a lot of people here that want.
We have two questions. This lady's question, and he has something about the structure of Godfather 2. Maybe we can answer those two.
Good.
What was the question about? Sorry, young lady. The structure of Godfather 2. Your question was. No, that was interesting about that. That was the concept of the script, to tell the story of a father and a son at the same time in parallel action in the same age. Interestingly, though, when we first cut it together, it would alternate every 10 minutes, more or less, and we found that it didn't work at all. And when we doubled it and made it be 20 minutes of one and 20 minutes of the other, then it started to work. Just interesting, but it was written with the back and forth kind of a shorter duration. The lady.
When the scenes of the murders always go along with the procession, with the church things, with the religion, so deeply in Italy, Sicily, and my country, Brazil, is that because you have those feelings and most of the actors also with Italian background share those feelings?
The question is the fact that the violence is sort of being expressed through imagery of religion and procession. I don't know. You know, it's like operas like Cavalleria Rusticana, and the tradition, in my mind, is there's a sort of odd pageantry to violence in certain, if you see it that way, or it certainly, you know, as we know historically, in the 17th century, the church, there was all kinds of incredible violence going between the struggle between the different, so I don't know, I just, in my mind, it seemed that there was a certain violent pageantry that was linked together.
I think one last thing about...
And an irony.
Just the music, you're talking about the music in this piece, and there very seldom do you have a score that is so definitive. And, you know, Nino Rota, when he did this, I mean, did you see La Strada and go on? Did you know?
I knew Nino Rota's music very well, but the score that really sealed it for me was Rocco and His Brothers. Because Rocco and His Brothers has this beautiful, deep, heartbreaking, tragic family story, and I felt that Nino Rota wrote that as well as the Fellini scores. But that was what cinched it for me.
Extraordinary.
What?
Do you think this film could be made
This film could be made today, but it wouldn't get a go-ahead. No, the major studio, which it would take. The first Godfather cost $6.5 million. The second Godfather cost about $11 or $12 million, which, if you convert that for the money, is it would take a major studio, but it would never get through the process of getting an okay, or what they now call a green light. Nothing can get a green light unless it's a movie that they can have a whole series of them, and pretty much a Marvel Comics type of.
And basically, there are not enough wires, I don't think, probably. Wires. Yeah.
What a voice.
You know, once Kirk Kerkorian, who owned MGM, asked me, he says, how do you make a film that is successful financially and also artistically? And I said to him, risk. Well, nobody wants the risk when you get into business. Pardon? Jokes? Oh, he and Jimmy and Bobby were constantly, Brando and you, making jokes and having fun.
During the wedding scene, we all were mooning each other, and Brando took it quite seriously. In fact, he gave out a world championship belt. And so he went for his belt, I went for my belt, and Coppola said, there are women and children here, you can't do that. But we did it. And when we mooned, some woman turned to me and said, Mr. Duvall, you're fine. She turned to her friend but said, but did you catch the balls on that Brando, she said. True story.
I remember when Brando came home from the hospital, and me and Bobby were supposed to carry him up the stairs. I'll do it right.
Keep it up.
I'll do it right. Yeah, we were supposed to carry him up on a stretcher. So he grabbed one, I grabbed the other end. I lifted up my testicles, hit my ankles. But I wasn't going to quit. When we lifted it up, and all of a sudden we were, he was laughing again. He put 500 pounds of weight under the mattress.
Francis, I don't think. I mean, do you have a favorite scene in the picture?
No. There's so many wonderful scenes in the cast, and so many beautiful scenes. I feel that an unsung hero in this is someone who's passed away, was the villain. Because if you have a good villain, you know, someone you take seriously, and I think Virgil Solozzo, played by Al Lettieri, yes, was. He was dangerous.
Yes.
Don't you think so? That made the whole story work better.
In the scene where Tom has been kidnapped, it's just a brilliant job of doing a scene in close-ups. It's very dark, and Solozzo's trying to convince Tom Hagen. But, you know, in the moment where we know that he's already hit the Don, you know, and we also know Luca Abruzzi is dead, and Tom says, well, you can do this, I can talk to this, but you can never stop Luca Abruzzi. And there's this close-up of Solozzo's face where you could just see it. It's not like he's leering, but he says, let me worry about Luca. It's the most fantastic moment.
What's really, for me, beautiful about that scene is that Bobby, when he gets the news that they've killed the he plays it not like the lawyer or the gopi, he plays it like the son. And you can see he's crying because his father has been killed.
And there is, again, the incredible moment where Tom Hagen has to tell Vito that Sonny's dead. And in that scene, there's another moment which is, you know, he's so wanting to have his, you know, and at the end of the scene, Brando goes over and lets him hug him. It's just incredibly, there's so much emotion in this.
They're a family, you know. I mean, that's what it really comes down to. That's what it really is all about.
Ladies and gentlemen, please give it up for the director and cast of The Godfather and The Godfather Part II.
Great. He wanted us out. Yeah, I'm a yeah.